Hey guys, so here we have my Alexa Mini on the left and my iPhone 15 on the right. We're first going to show the official Apple LUT as a contrast to my Alexa, and then wipe away the Apple LUT to reveal my Alexa emulation LUT. It's pretty wild how close we're able to get here, given this is an iPhone. You'll notice when comparing them a much more naturalistic cinematic look with the Alexa emulation LUT versus the official Apple LUT. And later in the video, we'll look at some actual technical issues with the Apple LUT, which really surprised me, given that Apple, you know, is a multi-trillion dollar company. Felt like they probably could have done a better technical job here. And for the uninitiated wondering what an Alexa Mini even is, the Alexa Mini is like the Ferrari of cinema cameras. It's what they shoot Hollywood blockbusters on and high-level commercials, and has the best skin tones in the biz, which are very flattering, while still remaining very naturalistic at the same time. So if you want to take your iPhone footage up a few notches, then this is definitely the camera to try to match to, for sure. I shot between 80 to 100 setups like this over 2 days with differing exposures, skin tones, lighting conditions, contrast ratios, to make sure I can get the most detailed and accurate data out of both cameras to match them as closely as you can see here. Okay, next we'll take a look at the Apple LUT and some of its issues. Stay tuned. Alright, so there are two main reasons why I personally don't like the Apple LUT. Number one is a technical reason. Number two is just an aesthetic reason. So number one, check this out. I was playing around with some footage and I noticed this odd thing happened where it's a shot of my son, and when it clipped here, it was clipping blue. It's very odd. Never seen that before with any other LUT, any other camera. So, I don't know, maybe Apple rushed this out, but for whatever reason, this is unacceptable. Like, from a technical point of view, you can't have your highlights being clipping blue. Now, obviously, it doesn't happen every time. I didn't notice it until this shot. I'd already shot a few days with it, but whatever's going on here in this particular scenario, something weird going on with the blue channel where it clips, and yeah, that's the result. So, that's not good. That's not good. But it actually leads into the second point, the aesthetic reason. Now, obviously, aesthetically, that sucks. But see here, this is not good. There's no highlight roll-off in the Apple LUT built into it. It's a filmic property, and it's also how our eye responds to brightness. Imagine like you've been in a dark room all day, and then you walk out in a bright outside, and it's bright and sunny. Like you're gonna see almost just pure white for the first few seconds. Like you look at the sky, it's just like a very pale blue, if it's got any color at all. And then when your eye slowly adjusts, you're gonna see normal natural colors again. So the eye sees very bright images and very dark images with not a lot of color. Cameras that model this create more naturalistic images because the eye is drawn to contrast and color saturation. As an example, think about the human eye itself. If you're looking at a human or even an animal that has an eye, what is an eye? Well, it's a white part called the sclera, and then you've got the iris and the pupil that sit in the middle, and they really pop against that white backdrop, you know, aka contrast and color. The iris always has a color in it. So your subconscious brain is always drawn to an eye. Now, this is the case even with babies. Babies look you in the eye. Animals look you in the eye. That's why. So when you're creating a LUT, or you're creating, you know, if you're a painter, whatever, anything from an aesthetic point of view, that principle is very important to remember. And your eye will be drawn to where there is most saturation and color. Sorry, most saturation and contrast. Now, a LUT, a well-designed LUT, will put that in the mids and the shadows, and the highlights will roll off to black and to white. But you can see here, you know, when you compare it to my LUT, see how it's actually a balanced white on my LUT, whereas it's like that, again, that bluey white even here in daylight. And notice the incredible harsh clipping point on the Apple LUT. Like it's just color white, like it's just vanishes all the information, whereas with my LUT, again, it's a bit more subtle, the roll off in it's because the saturation is getting lower and lower as we approach white. You know, and a good example would be even here at the end. Yeah, here. So see here, my LUT, there's not a lot of color saturation there. That's good because you want your eye to be drawn to the mids where there's most color and saturation. The Apple LUT, look at this. Look at this incredible weird white and then this ton of saturation up here. It's gonna pull your eye every time. Same here, this blobby color is not what you want. So, you know, I'm gonna keep moving because I'm trying to get this video short. But if you guys want me, by the way, to go into any more detail about this, let me know. Maybe I can do a YouTube live for the first time ever. Let me know in the comments. Okay, so here's another contrast between my LUT and the Apple LUT. It's another effect of what we were just talking about. So because the LUT has a ton of saturation in the highlights, you notice here this is very much on the Apple LUT, just one tone of orange, and the skin is, you know, in this table, actually a great example, the tables are really smeared yellow. Whereas in my LUT, you get a much more complex, dimensional, like three-dimensional image. You see the saturation of the color here. In the highlights, it starts to, the color backs off a bit. As a result, you see, compare this orange bib on my LUT to the Apple LUT. My LUT, the Apple LUT, a lot more, feels more like what you would have seen on the day. And again, the white cleans up a lot when it's bright. So you just get your eyes drawn here. Here, there's less discipline in the distribution of color, and the whole thing is just a big color fest. And it's like, just saturation isn't good. Like it isn't, that's not a rich color. A rich color is about having the right saturation in the right places, not in the wrong places. Here's another one we're gonna compare, an outdoor scene. Look at the LUT here, look what it does to the skin, the Apple LUT. It's not flattering, it brings out a lot of the red kind of blemishes you wouldn't want. No actor or someone on camera would want those parts of skin brought out. It's not very flattering. And there's, again, a lot of saturation on the bright side of his face. And we're gonna put my LUT back on. And now it doesn't look washed out, but it looks more natural and cinematic. And you can still see there's plenty of color in his lips. You know, we'll jump to this next setup here. You know, you can see with my LUT, there's still plenty of rich color saturation in the shadows where it belongs. But then with the Apple LUT, yeah, it's just again, less discipline. The other thing is shadow detail. My LUT, I spent a bit of time on this, getting my LUT right. So it brings out a bit more shadow detail. The Apple LUT crushes the shadows quite a lot. My LUT is a bit softer with the shadows. That's another good example. A lot of dynamic range here. The overexposed parts of my LUT are dutifully, you know, they're washed out as they should be. Look at the sky here, right? I'm gonna put the Apple LUT on. 3, 2, 1. Look at the sky here, that odd blue, Nintendo blue, that really is cut out against that green. And the skin as well, with the Apple LUT, it is too saturated. Whereas here you can see it's got more of a natural rendering. So that's that part over, guys. There's more I could talk about, but we'll keep moving. And next section, I'm gonna talk about my recommendations for how to actually use the LUT with the iPhone. Okay, so here I'm just gonna give you guys some tips on a couple of things I've learned owning the iPhone for about a month. Definitely get the Blackmagic app. It allows you to treat the camera like a cinema camera. You can control ISO, shutter speed, shutter angle, white balance, all those great things. And you can also preview the LUT in real time. So you can load up my LUT on the app and see what the final image is gonna look like instead of staring at like gray log when you shoot. Number two, get a good ND. I love Nisi's True Color ND. It's the best variable ND I've ever used for my other cameras, but when I got their iPhone one, it wasn't made for the 15 and I would not recommend that. So I've only tried that one. It just, I had an insane amount of IR pollution. So I'm not bagging Nisi. I like Nisi in general, but for some reason their iPhone ND really didn't work with the 15. So I spoke to them about it and they said they're gonna be coming out with a 15, you know, one specifically for the 15. They're just developing it because this has all happened quickly. So I've ordered a Polar Pro. I think it arrived today actually. And I'll give you guys an update if that's any good. But yeah, I've got really bad IR pollution on the Nisi that you can't really use it because all your blacks turn into like purpley magenta. Number three, don't shoot vertically. So I shot a ton of stuff when I first got it vertically. which the Blackmagic app allows you to do. What that essentially just does is it crops in on the sensor, so you end up with noisy, soft footage. I wouldn't recommend it. So you're gonna have to shoot holding the camera horizontally. You'll get a much nicer image that way. You guys will learn all this yourselves, but I'm just trying to give you a head start. The 77mm doesn't perform as well as the others, so I found the 24mm and the 13mm were really good. The 77mm, it feels like it crops on the sensor, like it also felt soft and noisy. I don't think it crops in on the sensor, but I could be wrong there. Anyway, I wouldn't say it's unusable, but just have a look at that when you get your hands on your iPhone and see what you think for yourself. Personally, ISO recommendations, I'd stick to between 100 and 400. It starts getting pretty noisy after. Now, there is heavy noise reduction on the phone, so even if you're not seeing noise after 400, you're seeing all the artifacts of noise reduction, which really messes with the quality of the image. That's, again, this is just, these are not rules, these are just my recommendations. I like to shoot between 1 and 400. And the lenses, yeah, it's very easy. Like, you're constantly reaching for your phone. It's very easy to get fingerprints on lenses. So just, if you're ever shooting anything that's important to you, just make sure you give it a clean or check it before you shoot. Because I've shot a few things where, yeah, it kind of, the smudge on the lens kind of ruined the shot from my fingertips. So that about does it, guys. Yeah.
Stay tuned to my YouTube channel. There will be a second iPhone 15 video coming in the next month or two where I'm going to set up 4 to 6 different kinds of scenes where I'm going to show what the iPhone can do with these LUTs. Just some more real-world test footage because I didn't really have time this time around to include in this video. I was recovering from a surgery and couldn't find an ND that worked either. So that'll be coming soon. I can't wait to show you that as well. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching and I hope you like the LUTs. Ciao. Oh, and don't forget to follow our Instagram where you can see a bunch of great work that the Phantom LUTs community is putting out. Okay, cheers, guys. Bye.